I'm going to present something quick. We're going to take a step back to this morning. We had a ton of great questions from this morning's panel. I want to kind of circle back and answer some of those, and then we'll get specifically to the structure discussion here. All right. So I'm going to put Joe and Colin and Mark on the spot. If you guys can unmute yourselves. There were just a ton of questions this morning as people were digesting what you had talked about with this new concept, expanding the channel evolution model to include this new possibility of stage zero. And when I read through the questions, what I see is a lot of folks asking about, you know, did stage zero occur everywhere? Is it appropriate everywhere? What are the geographic settings it was most common in all of that? So I want to talk a little bit here about that. And the thing that resonated with me, and I had Mark send this to me again, was I heard this concept described as like beads on a string, right? That the within a watershed, there's different types of reaches that are all informed by their valley setting. And so maybe you guys could talk a little bit about that. And Joe, I'll put you on the spot first, maybe kind of visit with us about, you know, this idea of stage zero. Where is it appropriate within just this watershed context?
Two words, it depends. Happens to be that we know what it depends on. Depends on the valley setting and that hydrogeomorphic setting. But mapping the valley bottom, as we'll learn how to do in module 3, is a great place to start. Obviously, to have anastomosing, you need to have a valley bottom that's big enough, and that can be really small valley bottoms sometimes, just small systems, but big enough to have channels and vegetated islands. So I'll stop there.
Great. Mark, are you on?
Yep, I'm here.
Can you add anything to this discussion?
The way Ellen Wold describes it, she also studies mountain kind of streams and headwaters and mountains, is this beads on a string. And the string part are these geologically controlled thin valley bottoms where they just can't get wide enough. And those are naturally transport reaches. So stage zero doesn't exist in those. And that's what I'm trying to show with this picture, actually mapping that out. So it's those beads that you're going for.
Great. Thank you. And then Colin, for you, if you're still available here, I can't see if that's if you're able to join us this afternoon.
Yep, I'm here.
Yeah, so building off of this idea, so folks were asking about, you know, did stage zero go to stage one and then back and forth over time? In other words, like a stage one channel could be highly stable with the vegetation and everything, but maybe if beavers moved in, it would go to stage zero, and then vice versa, like you lose beavers and it goes to stage one. Do you think something like that happened historically where it toggled back and forth between these different stages?
In a word, yes. You know, we tend to blame everything on ourselves, everything that happens to rivers. And of course, that's a pretty self-centered view. We have to remember the streams we see today have dealt with glaciers and tectonics and massive 500-year storms and giant beaver. You know, all of these things have happened, and here, here are our streams, and they're the outcome of everything that ever happened to them. And now we happen to them, and we're having impacts too. But no, the incision is part of the natural landscape forming process, and indeed in sediment source areas, that's where incision occurs, if not continuously, then predominantly. And I like Sean's classification of sources, transfer links, and sediment sinks. And stage zero, as we talked about it today, is mostly appropriate in a sediment sink zone where there's an active floodplain and sediment being put into storage. That doesn't necessarily mean that the channel is a grading, but it means that the floodplain is getting built by vertical accretion as well as by lateral processes. And Leopold Woolman and Miller were right, lateral processes are a big part of natural floodplain accretion. But you might say, well, wait a minute, and so still these are unstable, that floodplain is going to build higher and higher and higher, and that may be a problem to landowners and people who put transportation infrastructure online. Well, not necessarily, because floodplain soils also subside and compact naturally through time. So you may need some net aggradation on the floodplain actually to keep the elevation you've got and prevent it from sinking. So great. To answer the question, then, we're talking about response reaches using Montgomery and Buffington's classification. We're talking about sediment sinks, beads on a string, where the valley floor is wide enough. I agree with all of that. But everywhere, no, absolutely not everywhere. All the time, no, not all the time.
Excellent. All right, thank you. Yeah, I think that answers the question. Maybe it's human nature to latch on to the newest idea and say, we got to do that everywhere. But you guys have said already, that's not what you're talking about, that this is expanding our concept of what was actually out there on the landscape. And so appreciate you providing that. Joe, I'm going to stop sharing and have you put up the transitional slide again. And the one question I wanted to ask of Scott and Steve, I see a bunch of questions about permitting, right? And so we know in our later modules we're going to get to this, but let's go ahead and just, can you just maybe instill some confidence in folks that, you know, we can work through the permitting processes? There were questions about, you know, do we have to get Army Corps permits? And what about fish passage concerns? You know, how do we work through these things to put these structures on the ground? Can you just speak some wise words to us briefly and let folks know what they might hear later in the session?
Sure. Yes, I guess the permitting landscape is not, don't be intimidated by the permitting landscape. There are plenty of things out there that need to be considered, U.S. Army Corps stream bed alteration permits among them. Fish passage is one I might let Steve speak a little bit more to, being more active in the Northwest than I am. But in general, there's an increasing sort of awareness, I guess I would say, that these approaches are being widely employed. They're not as foreign as they were just a few years ago. They're being specifically addressed in a number of Western states where the language of BDAs is now being, you know, expressly articulated and some requirements for them are there. But it's not, I guess it's not to be feared. It's something that most people are comfortable working with you on, and I guess I'll leave it there and say, Jeremy, as you mentioned, we'll cover more of that a little bit later in the week.
Excellent. Perfect. Thank you. And Steve, you know, this is a bit of a can of worms. I know we'll talk about more of this on the science module tomorrow, but maybe just touch briefly on fish passage, that this is something we have been discussing and are aware of and have been working through.
Sure. I'm a fish biologist, and we were trained pretty well in the last numerous decades to be extremely worried about fish barriers because we've created a lot of anthropogenic barriers. But as Scott mentioned, people are becoming much more familiar with these structures, and in workshops like this, we're emphasizing the fact that they're not permanent, they're leaky, and often we have water flowing around these structures. And so as Oregon, using Oregon as an example, they've just gone through a process of reviewing their fish passage policies and have got fairly comfortable with the low-tech approach to building these structures. And as long as people say they're adhering to the principles and the general approach that we describe, both in this low-tech manual that we're presenting and in the beaver restoration manual that's already out, then they're not going to be nearly as concerned about these as fish barriers. And we have actual published papers showing that inland species as well as anadromous species do just fine getting around these structures.
All right. Well, thank you, Steve. I know there's a lot more that can be said on that, but we're going to go ahead and wrap up this. And Joe, I'm going to turn it over to you to talk about what we need to know about low tech and the principles behind it.